Hi dear children, now I welcome you to another session on photoelectric effect. So in the previous video or in the previous class, we have seen regarding the experimental observations conducted by Leonard and Horvath. Let us have a quick recap on what we have learned yesterday. So they plotted the variation of the photo current, that is the current due to the ejected photoelectron versus intensity of the incident radiation. The graph is observed to be a straight line, right? In the second graph, in the second experiment, they studied the variation of photo current with the accelerating voltage corresponding to different intensities, and it was seen that it attains a steady current called a photosaturation current. And we got, so this case we kept the frequency as a constant, and this value of potential difference is called the stopping potential. It is a minimum value of the reverse potential which can stop the, which can reduce the photo current just to zero, right? Or it is that potential which stops even the fastest photoelectron. So that is second experiment. In the third experiment we saw, here we kept the frequency constant. In the third experiment what we did is that we studied the variation of photocurrent with accelerating potential, but this time intensity is kept a constant whereas the frequency is varied. So this is the situation we got for the first one. This is nu V01, this is frequency nu1. Correspondingly the shape, saturation current is not going to change, so this is V02. And correspondingly the frequency is nu2 greater than nu1, right? And fourth graph we have seen is that this one only. The variation of the value of stopping potential with the frequency. It is observed that the graph is a straight line. And this frequency is called a threshold frequency. And this is for metal 1. And this is the shape of the graph for metal 2. So what is our conclusion? So these were the four observations that we got on the other day. So let us come to the conclusions of each. So let us take the first graph. What is the conclusion from the first graph? Let us look into it. The conclusion we can arrive from here is that for a given photosensitive material, for a given photosensitive material, comma, and frequency of the incident radiation, and frequency of the incident radiation, frequency of the incident radiation greater than threshold frequency, the frequency of the incident radiation greater than threshold frequency, what happens? Photocurrent is directly proportional to intensity of incident radiation. Intensity of incident radiation. This is observation number one, right? This is observation number one. So this is the first observation, right? For a given photosensitive material and frequency of the incident radiation greater than threshold frequency, the photocurrent is directly proportional to the intensity of incident radiation. Yes, now for the second graph, what we have seen is that this is the shape of the graph, right? So this is at intensities I1, I2 and I1. And we can see that they have the same stopping potential, right? So let me make a correction here. For a given photosensitive material and frequency of the incident radiation greater than threshold frequency, right? What is observed here is the value of the stopping potential is independent. Value of stopping potential. Value of the stopping potential is independent of intensity, right? is independent of the intensity, I can say. Is independent of the intensity of the incident radiation, right? For a given photosensitive material and frequency of the incident radiation greater than the threshold frequency. What do you mean by threshold frequency? The minimum frequency required to initiate photoelectric effect is called a threshold frequency. The value of the stopping potential is independent of intensity. That is point number two. Yes. Now coming on. So this is the case where we kept the frequency as a constant, right? In the third graph, what we did is we kept the intensity as a constant, and we have seen the current versus accelerating voltage. So here we keep intensity as a constant, and this is V01 for first frequency, for the second one V02. So we can see that the value of stopping potential increases with the frequency, right? The value of the stopping potential increases with the frequency, whereas saturation current is independent of frequency. Yes, saturation current is independent of frequency. Right, the stopping potential increases with the frequency, whereas the saturation current is independent of frequency. That is, we can see here, for a particular intensity, saturation current comes out to be the same throughout. So what does that mean? So if you look at the stopping potential V01, this is V02, this is frequency nu1, this is frequency nu2. I'm saying nu2 greater than nu1. So when the frequency of the incident radiation increases, what happens is that the value of the stopping potential is also increasing. This is observation number 3. Yes. So what the most highlighting part is this term, threshold frequency. If the frequency of the incident radiation is below threshold frequency, now photoelectric emission is possible. Photoelectric emission is impossible if the frequency of the incident radiation is less than what is the minimum frequency called a threshold frequency. Right. So now coming on to the fourth and important point from photoelectric effect. There is a fourth point on the observations made by Leonard and Holbrook, and that fourth point is photoelectric effect is an instantaneous process. Photoelectric effect is an instantaneous process. Instantaneous means an instant is an interval of time which is negligible. Photoelectric effect is an instantaneous process, which means there is negligible time delay. So which is of the order of a nanosecond, I tell you. Of the order of nanosecond. It's of the order of nanosecond. So there is negligible time delay. I'm sorry, it's not day. It's delay, time delay between the instance of incidence. Instance of light incident and emission of photoelectrons. There is only negligible time delay between the instance of incidence and the emission of photoelectrons. So what I would like to tell you is that the photoelectric effect is an instantaneous effect, and the time delay between the instance of incidence and the emission of light is very negligible, right? It's a negligible time interval what comes into play here, right? So this is an important point to understand regarding photoelectric effect. Ready? So these are the basic ideas of observations from Leonard and Holmworks. Now we need to explain about the failure of classical wave theory in explaining photoelectric effect. The failure of classical wave theory. Yes. How classical wave theory was a failure in explaining, failure of wave theory in explaining photoelectric effect. Now one thing you have to understand is that the intensity, according to the classical wave theory, the intensity of incident light is directly proportional to square of amplitude. Obviously, it is proportional to frequency. Also, it is proportional to F square, where F is the frequency. Now, what one can say here, if you increase amplitude, which implies intensity also must increase, right? What we have to say is that the role of frequency then can be minimized by amplitude, which means the required intensity can just be improved by increasing the amplitude, right? Just by increasing amplitude, you can increase intensity. Correspondingly, you could have made the emission of electrons, I have to say. But what you observe is that is not happening, right? What it says, according to the observations made by Leonard and Holmberg, what it says is that you require a minimum frequency. No photoelectric emission is possible if the frequency of the incident radiation is below that minimum frequency called the threshold frequency. How powerful the beam of incidence light be. What I have to say is that very important point I'm saying. So if the how powerful the incident radiation be, how strong the incident radiation be, use laser or whatever kind of light. What I say, laser is a powerful light. But if the frequency is below threshold frequency, photoelectric emission is impossible. I say, if the frequency is below threshold frequency, even laser cannot cause photoelectric emission. What is important there? So, what is important there is the requirement of threshold frequency. So, one of the most failures of classical wave theory is it failed to explain. It failed to explain the requirement of threshold frequency. So this is the first failure according to the classical wave theory. So no emission of photoelectrons is possible if the frequency of the incident radiation is below what is called a threshold frequency. No photoelectric emission is possible if the frequency of the incident radiation is below the threshold frequency. That is first limitation. Second limitation, it comes out to be, it failed to explain. The law again failed to explain what? How the process becomes instantaneous. It failed to explain how the process becomes instantaneous. That is the second failure of the classical wave theory. So two failures we have to take into consideration. First one is, it failed to explain the requirement of threshold frequency. The second failure is, it failed to explain how the process becomes instantaneous. So I told you there is only negligible time delay between the instance of incident and emission of the radiation. So both the wave theory was a big failure in explaining these two. So now what to do? We have to move to the next idea. That is where I'm going to consider the famous Sir Albert Einstein's explanation of photoelectric effect. Unfortunately, he didn't get the Nobel Prize for explaining the theory of relativity, but he got Nobel Prize for explanation of the photoelectric effect. So Einstein's explanation, that is what we are going to see. Einstein's explanation of photoelectric effect.
Einstein explanation of photoelectric effect. So let me tell you an important point. So it is based on the conservation of energy. Einstein's explanation was based on energy conservation. So what is energy conservation? Okay, let me tell you. So it's based on the quantum theory. So explanation was based on quantum theory proposed by Sir Max Planck. It was based on the quantum theory proposed by Sir Max Planck. What is according to quantum theory? The energy is equal to h nu. So energies are in the form of discrete packets called quantas. And the energy of a quanta is E is equal to h nu, where nu is the frequency of the radiation. Right, so we have learned it. Sir Albert Einstein considered this. So first point where he says that there should be a work function for every metal. That is fine. Okay, let us explain this. Suppose think that you are going for a journey and you require a certain sum, say 100 rupees to travel from place A to place B. You require 100 rupees to travel from place A to place B, but you have got only 80 rupees. Will it be possible? So we are avoiding all chances of accepting lift and all. You have to travel only by paying money. There is no other go for you. No other way you can reach from point A to point B. So that is where we are taking the first situation. Say if the incident energy. First point I am saying. If the incident energy is less than work function. What happens? Suppose that over the same situation I am saying. You are traveling from school to your home after the class. And you want to take some food from a hotel or bakery or cafeteria, whatever you say is, okay, wherever, place what you like to, you can assume in your mind. No problem in that. But how much you have got energy? You got this much money with you. How much you require? You require this much. You require this much money for doing what you would like to, but what is there with you is only this much. You require this much. Question, will you do the same? Will you go to that shop? What is the answer? No way. Okay, let me take phi is equal to h nu 0, where nu 0 is called a threshold frequency. Now, I'm saying if h nu less than h nu 0, right? Or I'm saying nu less than nu 0. The frequency of the incident radiation is less than the threshold frequency. What do you require is? Threshold frequency, what you have with you is just less than threshold frequency. Question, will it be possible to remove electrons? Will it be possible to remove electrons? Come on, reply. Will it be possible to remove electrons if nu is less than nu zero? Okay, so it's a quite simple answer. Then we cannot, nahi ho sakta. This won't happen, right? So we cannot remove electron as long as the incident frequency less than threshold frequency, right? That is case one for you. Now taking the second case, if the incident energy is equal to threshold frequency, right? So that means you have got enough money to go to the cafeteria. Chai pile, coffee pile, so kya kya karna hai, wo zara kar dijiye. So you got this much energy with you. So you got... How much energy? You got energy to go to that coffee shop or wherever you want to go. So in this case, nu is equal to nu zero, right? So electrons are just ejected. Electrons are just ejected, right? So in this case, electrons will just get ejected, I have to say. Just electrons will just come out of this plate. In the third case, what you have got? Yes, that is important. So, EI greater than phi. So, how much energy you got? So, nu greater than nu zero. That means you have got more money. So, lavish. So, what we are going to do? We are going to do dumma chale dum. Right? So, you got energy greater than nu zero. So how much energy you have got? You got more than the required energy. Plenty of energy with you. Right. So Go to cafeteria, go for a movie, go for something else, whatever, right? So that is where we are going to take into consideration of Einstein's energy conservation. So incident energy greater than work function. Incident energy greater than work function. So what I am going to say here is H nu. So we require, we have got a total energy H nu. How much we have to take for removing electron? That is equal to H nu 0. Then what the remaining will appear as? According, so assuming no loss of energy. Assuming no loss of energy, this energy will appear as the kinetic energy of the photoelectron. So this is the maximum possible kinetic energy of the photoelectron. And let me tell you, this is the most important equation as proposed by Sir Albert Einstein. So H nu is the incident energy. H nu incident energy, H nu zero work function, K max is the kinetic energy of the fastest photoelectron. Then I may ask you the question. What will be the, so is this equation applicable to all electrons? Answer is no. One thing I will say is that from which level the electrons are ejected, not clear. And let me tell you, this equation is applicable for the most energetic electron. Energetic electron, or otherwise I will tell you the fastest photoelectron. So an important point you have to understand that kinetic energy of photoelectrons vary from 0 to Ke max. It may vary from 0 to Ke max. So it is applicable to the fastest photoelectron. Ke max is the energy of the fastest photoelectron. So let me tell you, this particular equation is applicable for the fastest photoelectron. Then, now we have to say, what is stopping potential? Stopping potential is that potential which stops even the fastest photoelectron. Stops the fastest photoelectron. So I can say, so work done is equal to EV0, right? I will put minus because it is stopping. It is opposite to the displacement of the electron, right? So displacement is towards right, electric field is towards left. So I'll put minus EV0. This is equal to final kinetic energy 0, initial kinetic energy Ke max, right? Work done. According to the first year, we have learned that work done is equal to the change in kinetic energy. So for stopping potential, V0 is called stopping potential. Stopping potential means what potential? It is that potential which stops even the fastest photoelectron. Which stops even the fastest photoelectron. Right. So minus EV0. From here I go, K max is equal to what? EV0. K max is equal to EV0. Now we are substituting for that EV0 in this equation. Sorry, substituting for K max in this equation, what I am going to get? Which implies I will get the photoelectric equation H nu is equal to H nu V0 plus EV0. This is another version of the Einstein's photoelectric equation. Now we can see from here V0 is equal to H by E into nu minus H by E into nu 0. That is what we have seen in the graph, right? So this is the graph we have seen for stopping potential versus frequency. So Y intercept is initially negative. So you can see the graph up to this. And this frequency is nu 0. When nu is equal to nu 0, the stopping potential is equal to 0. When nu is equal to nu 0, when these two are equal, when nu 0 is equal to nu, first term is equal to the second term, then the difference is equal to 0, right? Now that means the graph is a straight line from here. And what will be the slope of this graph? The slope of this graph is equal to h divided by e. The slope of the graph is equal to H divided by E, right? And that is why we have seen for different metals, the graph is a straight line, right? Because the slope of this graph is a universal constant. The slope of this particular graph is a universal constant. So This is another version of Sir Albert Einstein's photoelectric equation. Now we got an expression for V0. The value of V0 is equal to H by E into nu minus H by E into nu 0. Now in terms of wavelength, we will write this. In terms of wavelength, we will write this. Okay, yes. How can we write it? Nu is equal to C by lambda. So this is HC by lambda is equal to HC divided by lambda 0 plus KE max. Or this also becomes HC divided by lambda is equal to HC divided by lambda 0 plus EV0, right? So I am telling you the important fact, this equation is applicable only to the most energetic photoelectron. This equation is applicable only to the most energetic photoelectron. It is not applicable to every electron. This is applicable only to most energetic photoelectron or the fastest photoelectron. Now, an important thing you have to understand is that the value of HC can be written as 1240 electron volt nanometer, or this is 12400 electron volt angstrom. So this will help you in solving problems. It will ease your problem solving abilities. And let me tell you, if I plot a graph between, instead of V0, we can take it as 1 by lambda also. So this becomes 1 by lambda 0. Right? So, which means photoelectric emission is possible if 1 by lambda greater than 1 by lambda 0. Photoelectric emission is possible if and only if 1 by lambda greater than 1 by lambda 0 or lambda 0 greater than lambda. It's a condition where photoelectric emission is possible. In all other conditions, no photoelectric emission is possible. So, understand that frequency greater than threshold frequency, correspondingly wavelength less than threshold wavelength. So, this is an important point to understand. Now coming on to the interesting part of, so Einstein's photoelectric equation is proof. He got Nobel Prize, I hope, in the year. Check it and find it. I think it is 1921 or 23. I'm not sure about the year exactly. Check it and find it. Millikan, sir, tried to, so by some jealousy, just a joke I'm saying. Sir Millikan tried to disprove Sir Albert Einstein's photoelectric equation. How? He tried to prove that what Sir Albert Einstein said, what H nu is equal to H nu 0 plus EV 0. I want to prove it wrong. Sir Millikan tried to prove it wrong. But unfortunately, what happened is that he was able to prove it right. This equation is absolutely right. So, he supported Sir Albert Einstein by proving this relation absolutely correct. And he was able, using this equation, experimentally, he found the value of the Planck's constant H. And you know the value of Planck's constant H. What is the value? 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34. Unit kya hai? Joule. Joule. Per second. Oh, sorry. Joule second. It's joule second. That's a value of H. I hope this is absolutely clear to you. This is regarding the explanation of photoelectric effect by none other than the great Sir Albert Einstein.